know what is an anthill casting? Even if you don't, there's a good chance you have seen videos like this. The process is quite straightforward. Essentially, just using the anthill as a mold, you pour liquid metal down the entrance of one until it's completely full. Then wait for the metal to cool down and dig up the whole thing. Normal anthills people find in their backyard is usually the size of a football, but those found in the wild, unrestrained by human structures and, well, exterminators, can easily go deeper, wider than your wildest imagination. But only by casting the anthill and removing it from the ground, an action that irreversibly destroys it, can the true complexity of this subterranean city be revealed. This anthill in Brazil is 8 meters deep and covers an area of 50 square meters. Yet, this is only one isolated colony. The largest single super colony in existence denies us even this brute force method of bringing it to light. Spanning across 6,000 kilometers in southern Europe, this super colony is estimated to consist of millions of interconnected legs. We humans, like ants, build tunnels and chambers underground. Metro system is stable of many modern cities. These underground networks of tunnels are especially prominent in tightly packed urban areas. Millions go down into the tunnels and emerge again miles away as part of their daily routine. When people think about the metro system, be it the subway, the underground, the tube, the MTR, they picture a bright, safe place. Well, maybe not exactly safe depending on where you live. But at least it's not this.
Dark tunnel, wheel rattle, and the smell of death.
Before writing Metro 2033, Dmitry Gohorsky spent hours every day commuting in the Moscow metro system. And during that time, he saw it for what it actually is. It is a vast, unfathomable, and endless darkness. Because initially, it wasn't designed solely with mass transportation in mind. While it will never be officially confirmed, it's obvious just by looking at how it's built. Trapons, airlocks, air filtration, its own generators and water supply betray its purpose as the world's largest nuclear shelter, let alone the existence of the secret metro tube, a parallel system separated by mere meters. What they are telling us is that the warm, welcoming metro is just an illusion, a mere front for the underground labyrinth we have built. Published in 2002 and later adopted into video games, Metro 2033 is built upon the idea that the Moscow metro system is the world's largest underground shelter. The story is that in an alternate version of the year 2033, in which World War III has destroyed the world. The survivors fled into the underbelly of Moscow in order to escape nuclear devastation. But what awaits them is not safety, but long, dark tunnels that house endless horror. By 2033, they have already been down there for 2 decades. It's enough time for the artificiality of the tunnel to fade away. The bright tunnels are no more. In their place are miles upon miles of just void. And do not let this map fool you into thinking metro system is just one long tunnel with some stations scattered along the way. In order to maintain the comfortable illusion for millions of passengers, countless utility tunnels, air ducts, and bypasses are dug all over the place. When they are not functioning, water and toxic gases can easily accumulate in these tunnels, making them a death trap. Underground tunnels are not naturally warm and welcoming. They are this way only because we keep it so. If left unattended, they will revert back to their true state of being. In our world, such place also exists, in the Siberian city of Omsk. 30 feet under the surface, 8 kilometers of steel and concrete left to rot. The Omsk Metro was planned to include 10 stations when it started construction in 1992. Yet only one station is completed by the time the project is cancelled in 2018. But the completed tunnel are not going anywhere. It's just there. Expecting no visitor except the occasional fuel seekers. Still rusts, concrete cracks when water freezes into ice. It's only then the underworld is disenchanted. When reality sets in, we realize even though we built the tunnels, we do not belong here. The dark, cold underworld is by nature an unwelcoming environment for humans. Although for some, it is their only choice. Human is not an underground species. Our eyes are not adapted for darkness. Our ears aren't nearly precise enough to help either. We even get sick simply by not having enough sunlight. Despite everything, people still lived underground. Not by choice, but by circumstances. For some, it's a matter of survival. In 2020, construction workers in Turkey discovered an ancient tunnel system that's believed to refuge early Christians from Roman persecution during the 2nd and 3rd century. These aren't just escape tunnels, but full-fledged habitat with living area, storage, and place of worship. They estimate this place once held 70,000 early Christians, who were forced to live out of sight under the dim candlelight. And in modern metropolis, there are still homeless people whose only choice is to go underground, or risk freezing. The more people, as they are called, live in abandoned tunnels and storm drains beneath major cities like New York City and Las Vegas. Extreme temperature means that if they stay on the street, they will perish from exposure. And it goes without saying, the condition underground isn't much better, as these unregulated tunnels are prone to accidents and flooding. But where else can you go when you are homeless and it's minus 10 degrees outside? Sometimes you don't even need to move underground yourself. People can just decide to build over your head. Now you are the new underground. This is exactly what happens to the resident of Mary King's Close. In 1753, the Edinburgh Royal Exchange starts construction. Instead of locking down the existing buildings, they just use them as foundation and expect the people underneath to just move away, which some did, some didn't, and some simply couldn't. Building over the poor is also a recurring theme in basically every cyberpunk story. Height is always an indication of wealth and status. When the CEOs overlook the city in their penthouse office, the rest struggle in the shadow of their corporate master. Some sci-fi story took this idea to their logical conclusion by introducing the layered city, with the poor swept under the rug, out of sight, and out of mind. In this world, even sunlight is a privilege. Only those up on the sky can enjoy. The rest of us are left buried under the cold steel and concrete. Do you know what else we bury? Human remains. They are the reminder of the inevitable finality that awaits all of us at the end. Yet, it's something that we rarely choose to confront. You might have heard of the massive catacombs beneath the city of Paris. As the city and its population grew, so did the amount of dead bodies. By 1780, the city's cemetery was literally running out of space. The basement of a nearby building reportedly collapsed under the immense weight of all the dead bodies. So, they moved the bodies into centuries-old mining tunnels beneath the city. 6 million were stuffed into space that is never meant to house anything, let alone human remains. The tunnels are never meant to be anything but passageway. They are a mere byproduct of us extracting whatever we needed out of the ground. It's narrow, unstable, and probably a very dangerous place to even be inside of. But ironically, a bad place for a living human is also a good place for the dead. After all, if you are going to take an eternal nap, wouldn't you want some place dark and quiet? Today, most of the catacombs is closed to the public. Only a tiny portion is open as a tourist attraction. Yet, dangerous catacombs and dead people seem to form a deadly combination irresistible to thrill seekers and self-proclaimed explorers. Outside of official tours, there are many so-called cataphiles who often explored uncharted and insecure parts of the catacombs. While only 2 kilometers of the catacombs is accessible to normal tourists, the rest of the tunnel system is 100 times longer. It's rumored that every once in a while, a cataphile will dive deep into the catacombs and never emerge again, lost in the labyrinth we built, but will never belong to. In the 2014 found footage movie, As Above, So Below, the catacombs is quite literally the 9 circles of hell, as depicted in Dante's Inferno. The protagonist of the film, a young archaeologist who inherited her father's research, dives deep into the catacombs. She's then confronted with the ghosts of her past. It is a place where you will only find fear, regret, and death. And like Dante, one must pass through each circle of hell, facing the things that they have buried underground, and finally reaching the center of hell before they can be freed from it. You might have noticed I avoid talking about caves or other natural structures. Indeed, nearly everything made by nature can surpass our puny creation in scale and complexity. The thing about metro system, Mary King's Cross, and the catacombs of Paris is that they are 100% unambiguously man-made. There's no Irish horror or Asian aliens here. We made these things. We are supposed to know them like the back of our hands. Yet, we don't. The underground is for the dead and the oppressed. We can try our best to make it look warm, safe, and welcoming, but no one goes into an underground labyrinth and say, "This is where I want to spend the rest of my days." When the artificial lighting goes out, what we are left with is an unbearable abyss, in which lies past traumas. Things that we as individuals and as a society refuse to confront.